Hi guys, my name's Jordan, and in this video, we're taking a look at a massive ant colony of mine, housed in a meter-long terrarium, living alongside an abundance of plants, and other invertebrates too. They are Phaidolae, commonly known as big-headed ants. I've been raising this colony for around 3 years now. If you've seen some of my older videos, you'll be quite familiar with them and their upbringing. But just to recap, they were originally raised up from a single queen, found during nuptial flights, and then housed within a test tube setup. A few months later, the queen's first generation of workers finally arrived, and the colony was underway. Because these ants are polygynous, meaning they'll gladly accept more than a single queen within their individual colonies, once this colony had reached about 50 workers or so, I added in a couple more. As they matured, they started producing soldier casts, very odd looking ants, with huge, disproportionately sized heads. So you can see where their common name of big-headed ant comes from. At this point, the colony had 3 queens and was expanding incredibly fast. And they even started producing some winged reproductive ants, known as elates. It soon became a real challenge to provide the ants with the nesting space that they required. And so, I got to work on building them a new, more permanent home. What I came up with was a naturalistic dirt setup, with rocks and plants. The ants happily moved into this new environment and have been thriving ever since. Today, over a year later, the desert-themed terrarium, which I originally envisioned, has become overrun with plants and has transformed into a lush, green, forest-like environment. And the ants have been growing alongside the plants equally as fast. I estimate the colony must now have at least tens of thousands of workers strong. Below the surface, you can see just how productive they've been. Tunnels wind their way all around the setup, each leading to a chamber packed full of brood. This one here is full of pupae, the second to last stage of an ant's development. You can see they vary in colour, from a bright white to a light orangey brownish colour. The darkest ones are the furthest developed, very close to transforming into their final stage, an adult ant. Judging on their size and shape, these ones here are destined to become workers. But they've been producing more than just workers too. Lately, they've been giving rise to more elates, and quite a lot of them too. Here in Melbourne, big-headed ants tend to have their nuptial flights in autumn. This is where all the elates leave their nests, fly up into the air, and mate with elates from foreign colonies. This year, on a warm and humid April evening, the conditions were perfect. Wild colonies from all over were flying en masse. And so too was my colony. The elates would crawl up the plants and the sides of the tank as high as they could and take off. Most of them managed to work their way up and out of the tank, and then proceed to fly out the open window, positioned directly behind the terrarium. But there were some who were struggling to find their way, so I carefully collected up all these stragglers, and later released them outside. Not all the elates made it out safely, however. Some encountered some trouble along the way. Spiders. Lots of spiders. I always knew there were a few living in here, but I had no idea there were this many. It's as if they sensed them coming, and they all made the most of their opportunity, each eagerly entrapping as many as they could. Some with several all to themselves. The flights went on almost every day for 2 weeks straight. I couldn't believe just how many elates the colony had. It was like an endless stream. There were hundreds, possibly thousands. And night after night, I collected up containers full of all of the stragglers, sending them free out into the wild, so they could potentially spread their genes and bring rise to new colonies of their own, essentially giving back to Mother Nature. It was such a satisfying and humbling experience. Although, as good as it felt contributing to the survival of their species, it did become a little tedious collecting up all the ants scattered across my room, all because they couldn't find their way out the open window. So when they fly again next season, I want to be a little bit more prepared for the event. What I think I'll do is encircle the top of the terrarium with some sort of fine netting and then have it tightly fit up to the window, making that their only exit point. We'll see how it goes. What I love about big-headed ants, and part of the reason that this colony has progressed as well as they have, is the fact that they'll eat just about anything. Usually, whatever I place in, these ants are all over, within seconds. They absolutely love their fruit. Once every few days, I'll place in an apple core, and within an hour or so, they'll have made little tunnels all the way through, making sure to get at all the sweet juices within. They also love legumes, like beans and peas. They hollow them out and leave nothing but the waxy skins behind. And they love seeds as well, like chia and quinoa. And especially seeds which have fleshy elaiosomes. Bigheads are often referred to as harvester ants, as they often collect and store such seeds in little granaries within their nests, saving them for later consumption. Some of these seeds inevitably end up germinating before this can happen, and within the humid, nutrient-rich conditions of the ant's nest, they thrive. So by collecting and storing these seeds, the ants inadvertently benefit the surrounding plant life. And once these plants eventually mature, they'll then drop their seeds, and the mutually beneficial cycle continues. Bigheads are really quite important seed dispersers within many ecosystems. They also go crazy for nuts, their favorite of which are almonds and walnuts. I usually crush them up into fine bits, so then they can just pick up the fragments and take them straight down into the nest to feed their hungry brood. But every now and then, I'll just split them in two or offer them whole and just watch the colony slowly employ their soldiers to come out and break them down. Their huge heads are full of muscle, making them perfect for cutting and crushing even the toughest of foods. And of course, like most ants, bigheads love eating bugs too, and they aren't fussy with what. From mealworms, to dragonflies. They even went for this massive slug here, which must have come in on a piece of wood that I placed in as decoration. At first, the ants would clumsily get stuck in the slug's goo, and end up getting smothered by this sticky stuff. Definitely not the nicest way to go. But later, the ants cleverly began picking up little bits of substrate and placing it on top of the slug. The sticky goo would then soak up and off the slug and into the substrate, allowing the ants to freely bite into its flesh and proceed to slowly kill and consume it. So with big-headed ants, anything goes. It's no wonder they're so diverse and widely distributed. Currently, there's over 1,000 different species listed in their genus, Phidoli, and likely a whole lot more still just waiting to be discovered, making them not only the most diverse of ants, but of insects as a whole. Despite the colony's success, I've noticed a fair amount of mold and fungi slowly accumulating around the setup. Normally what I do to solve this problem is introduce a cleanup crew in the form of isopods. Worms. Millipedes and springtails. These bugs are great additions to any terrarium as they actively feast upon mold, fungi, and rotting vegetation, keeping the environment nice and clean and healthy for all of its inhabitants. And sometimes I even see them going for the ants' food too, peacefully eating side by side. Today, however, the ants have completely taken over, occupying virtually every crack and crevice throughout the terrarium. There simply isn't any safe place for these helpful bugs to hide. So the cleanup crew tends to end up as ant food. Once they're spotted, the ants quickly spread the word, and within seconds, they're completely covered in these little fiends. They do their best to try and escape, but the ants are relentless in their pursuit. Eventually, they grow exhausted from their struggling, and then the ants freely move in for the kill. So now, without a cleanup crew, I'll need to develop an alternative means of keeping the terrarium free from excessive mold and fungi. If you guys have any suggestions on how I could proceed, leave me a comment below. So I hope you've enjoyed this brief look at my big-headed ant colony. I just love these little guys. For any of you out there who are interested in keeping ants, I highly recommend giving big-headed ants a go. Their willingness to eat anything, their small size, inability to sting, fast growth rates, and the fact that they can be found virtually anywhere in the world makes them very beginner-friendly ants. I also highly recommend trying out a naturalistic setup, like this one. You obviously won't be able to see as much of the ants' nesting activities as you would in, say, a more traditional style nest. But for some, watching the ants come up to forage, and maybe occasionally seeing some tunnels and chambers up against the sides, is more than enough. And aesthetically, it's hard to beat something like this. The greenery really livens up a room. I'll be doing a tutorial on how to set up and maintain one of these environments in an upcoming video, so stay tuned for that. And now, as promised, we're running another contest. First, let's reveal the winner of last video. Last time, I asked, what do you find most interesting about ants? Quite a tricky question to answer, I know. There's just so many fascinating aspects to ants. I'd have to say, what most interests me is the fact that there's around 20,000 species of ants, and each one is unique. Some so drastically different from one another that it's like comparing an elephant to a squirrel. Like the massive bull ants and the super tiny shield ants. Or the arboreal and sure-sided green tree ants. And the almost entirely subterranean and virtually blind Dracula ants. Ants' immense level of diversity is truly remarkable. So I've read through all of your comments, and I was quite touched by your responses. It was great to get a better understanding on not only why you guys like ants, but also on how they've positively impacted your lives. I think a lot can be said on the therapeutic value of caring for and observing these little creatures. I had a really tough time picking my favorite answers. So we thought we'd offer some runner-up prizes too. So congratulations to Rebecca Howes and Joshua Ray Simpson. You both just won yourselves one of our size 1 acrylic nests, perfect for raising a young colony, or even just a founding queen. And finally, the main prize goes to Anthony Reynolds. Congratulations, you've just won yourself one of our size 3s. For the next video's contest, I want to know what your favourite ant species is, and why. To enter, just leave your answer in the comments section below. And we want to see some pictures of these ants too. Simply post a photo you've taken of them on Instagram, and make sure to tag us, Ants Australia, so we can find it. We'll pick out a single comment here on YouTube, and a single photo over on Instagram. And the winner will each receive one of our size 3 acrylic nests. Best of luck, guys. As always, thanks for watching this video, and I hope you enjoyed it.